Hello friends, today we are going to start a new topic in the field of spectroscopy. Today's topic is NMR spectroscopy. So in this video, we are going to learn about introduction to the NMR spectroscopy. As you know, my name is Dr. Gaurang Dubal and we are going to start. NMR is a form of absorption spectroscopy. Always keep in mind, NMR is absorption spectroscopy. Now we are going to see the history, phenomena of nuclear magnetic resonance. That is NMR. Nuclear magnetic resonance is the full form of NMR, right? Nuclear magnetic resonance was first reported independently in 1946. 1946 by two group of physicists. Nowadays, NMR is mainly used in chemistry, maximum use in chemistry, but the discovery of NMR was done by the physicist Bloch, Hansen and Packard at Stanford University detected the signal from proton of water. Proton of water and Purcell, Torrey and Pound at Harvard University observed a signal from the protons in the paraffin wax. So the first group at Stanford University, that is Blake, Hansen and Packard, identified the proton of water, and Purcell, Torrey and Pound at Harvard University find out the proton present in the paraffin wax. Bloch and Purcell were jointly awarded in the Nobel Prize of Physics in 1952 for this discovery of NMR. Since that time, in the advances in the NMR techniques leading to widespread applications in the various branches of science resulted in the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1991. So the first Nobel Prize awarded in 1952 for physics, and the Nobel Prize for NMR in the field of chemistry came in the 1991. The applications of NMR in clinical, solid state and biophysical sciences are really marvelous. They are really marvelous. Now we are going to see nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy involves transition of a nucleus from one spin state to another with the resultant absorption of electromagnetic radiation by spin active nuclei when they are placed in the magnetic field. The energy associated with NMR experiments is incapable of disturbing even weakest chemical bonds. Now, the typical applications of NMR spectroscopy. So NMR spectroscopy can be used for first purpose, structural chemical elucidation. That is in natural product chemistry, synthetic organic chemistry, analytical tool for choice of synthetic chemist. It must require nowadays for the organic synthesis and used in conjunction with mass and IR. So if you have a data pursuing IR, mass and NMR, you can easily prove your synthesized compound structure. And nowadays it is a widespread use of chemical structure elucidation in the field of NMR. Second use, study in dynamic processes. The NMR is used to determine the reaction kinetics, study of equilibrium, for chemical structure elucidation. And structural three-dimensional studies, protein, protein ligand complex, DNA, RNA, protein or DNA complexes, or it can be also used for the purpose of polysaccharide analysis also. So this is the third use. The fourth use is in metabolomics. The fourth use is in metabolomics. Fifth use is in drug design. Structure activity relationship, the short form is SAR by NMR. Structure activity relationship by NMR. And the sixth use currently is in medicine, that is magnetic resonance MRI. So that is MRI is also working on the principle of NMR. So these are the six key applications for the NMR. Next, NMR spectroscopy can be divided for learning in main four parts. First, proton nuclear magnetic resonance, or you can say 1H nuclear magnetic resonance. It is also known as 1H NMR also. It is also known as PMR also. Another 13C nuclear magnetic resonance. It is another NMR spectroscopy where you are analyzing the molecule against 13C, isotope of C12, right? So it is another NMR spectroscopy. And NMR spectroscopy is also applied for 19F, 15N, 31P, 77 selenium, 119SN, and 199 mercury. NMR paramagnetic molecules. So these molecules are also able to give NMR, and in typical specific uses, we are doing the NMR spectroscopy for these molecules. But it is rarely used, not commonly. And another important part is two-dimensional NMR spectroscopy, where we are taking the NMR spectra in two dimension, X and Y axis. Nuclear magnetic resonance, the short form is NMR. Spectroscopy is basically another form of absorption spectroscopy, as we told earlier. Under appropriate condition in a magnetic field, a molecule can be absorbed radio frequency wave. Always keep in mind the frequency wave or radiation which used for the NMR, that is nothing but radio frequency waves. Radio frequency waves are used for conduction of NMR spectroscopy. Absorption is a function of certain nuclei in a molecule. Means absorption is a function of nuclei in molecule. And a plot of frequencies of absorption peak versus their intensities constitute a NMR spectrum, right? That is NMR spectra. All nuclei carry a charge. In some nuclei, this charge spins on nuclear axis and thus generating a magnetic dipole along axis. You can see molecule is spinning. Molecule is getting spinned in their own axis. In their own axis and also moving to the main axis. So molecule is spinning in two way. On the axis and taking the round on its own axis also. Now a question may be arise, which atom will be NMR active, which element can be NMR active, or which will be NMR inactive. For that, you have to see in many books, there are so many options given which will be active, which will be inactive. But you have to only keep in mind the nuclei having odd molecular mass will be always NMR active. Forget all the terms, whatever terms you are getting in many books, this type of terms is given in many books, but forget all things and keep in mind only one thing, that is odd wood mass nuclei always will be NMR active. And when spin quantum number i equal to zero, there will be no NMR. You will found no any NMR. For spin quantum number I equal to zero, you will never get NMR. Spin quantum number determines the orientation of a nuclei in uniform external magnetic field. Orientation when 2i equal to 1. Put I equal to 1 by 2, the orientation will be 2. Orientation will be 2 and you will get some NMR. Right? So, two energy levels. So, transition is possible for that. And the radio energy for the transition is correlated with magnetic field by fundamental NMR. That is nu equal to gamma b0 by 2 pi. Here you will be surprised to know some new terms, but no worries. Nu means frequency. Frequency in NMR, we are using radio frequency wave. So the frequency nu equal to radio frequency, which you are using. Gamma will be constant. Magnetogyric ratio constant, that is gamma. For proton, the value will be 26750. B0 is applied magnetic field. Applied magnetic field means magnets, heavy magnets you are using for the conduction of NMR. Resonance condition for proton. In a field of 14092 Gauss, the required frequency is 60 MHz. In field of 2.33 Tesla, the required frequency is 100 MHz. And you know 1 Tesla equal to 10 raised to 4 Gausses. It will found in many reference books. Now if you see the NMR spectrum, you will see like that. One axis here, one axis here. In this axis, absorption of radiation will be there. And here the magnetic sweep will be there. So you will found some signal if molecule is NMR active. And in NMR, you have to keep in mind that the right hand side is high field where values are low. Values are low. Means here it may be 1. I am taking the red color for the denotation. It will be easy for you people. See, here value will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, dot, dot, dot. Up to here it is 10, 11, it may be 12, up to 14, right? So here the low values of NMR is considered as high field. It is considered as high field, or you can call as up field also. In some books, in some literature, you will find up field, that is high field, and the values in NMR are low, means in between 0 to 5, etc. Right? So the upfield is low NMR value and downfield or low field is high NMR value, like 6 to 12, etc. Right? So low NMR field is high NMR value. NMR value if high, then the field will be considered as low. It will be considered in the downfield. Principally, all the protons in the organic compound will give only one signal. Only one signal. But all protons absorb at same effective field, but do not absorb at the same applied field. Due to the different environments of the proton, and hence, number of signal observed in the NMR spectrum. So if you assume they will give only one signal, right? It is not like that. You may get more signals also. How? Why? By which rule? That we are going to see in the next videos, right? So this is all about the basic introduction of NMR spectroscopy. From the very next lecture, very next video, we are going to learn another deep study of NMR in the next videos. Thank you.